This is not necessarily part two of the exam. I've just taken all the skills that you're going to need to pass the Adobe Photoshop certification exam and place them into two different videos. The first section that we're going to cover in this video is working with tools. Let's pull our tools panel down to the middle so that we can check out some of the tools. Guys, here the double arrows will switch from a single column to a double column. I really like the double column. I just find it's easier to get to. At the bottom of the tools panel, you will find your foreground and your background color. When you first open Photoshop, it's gonna show you the defaults, which is black for the foreground and white for the background, which makes a lot of sense when your documents are white. The double arrows here will switch or swap your foreground and your background color. And at any time, you can double click on a color to open the color picker, pick with your eyes, enter in your RGB or your CMYK values, or usually on the exam, they'll give you the hexadecimal to enter. Just enter the hexadecimal they give you in the exam, guys. Super easy. If we move over to our Scarlett McCall image, and then choose the quick selection tool, we can resize our brush quickly on the fly using the bracket keys on the keyboard. And the quick selection tool is going to select in a painting motion. So sort of resize your brush to the area that you're going to paint. Take your time if you want. Go quickly if you want. You can always add to this selection or take away from this selection. And as you see, pretty quickly, it takes a pretty good selection of the area that you're trying to select. Now, we may want to command copy or control copy that image. Let's come over to our brushes and color image and then hit command V to paste. I can always hit command T to transform. Remember, with transform, you can move, you can scale, you can rotate. Don't forget to apply the transformation by hitting the check up in the control panel or hitting enter on the keyboard. So that's the quick selection tool. If I come over and make these two layers temporarily invisible and select my background layer, as you can see, I already have an image on the background. Maybe these layers were flattened earlier. I may want to switch to a different selection tool. In this case, I'm going to click and hold and select the magic wand. The magic wand selects based off pixel color, so if I need to select the background with one single click, I can click, and there I have my selection of the background. You can always come up to select and do different things with your selection. You can select the inverse, you can deselect, you can modify your selection. Maybe you want to expand the border of your selection. You can grow your selection, select similar colors that you clicked on before. In this case, I'm going to deselect. Next, if we want to select the bird and not the background, I may want to switch to this other selection tool called the object selection tool. If my background is solid or maybe it's defocused, I can take the object selection tool, click and drag a box or a rectangle over the object that I want to select. Photoshop is going to do a great job of selecting the object, and then there's my selection. We'll deselect our image by hitting Command D or Control D. Now we'll move on to some of our painting tools. In this case, I want to take a look at some of our brushes. Here I have our brush tool, our pencil tool, and then a few other tools, our color replacement tool and our mixer brush. Brush tools and pencil tools are pretty self-explanatory. You can go to Window and down to Brushes to open your Brushes panel. There you have a lot more control over your brushes. We can even create a new brush. First, we'll resize our brush. We'll click on the Brush Settings tab and click on the Shape Dynamics. Here we can give it a size jitter if we like. We can also control things like the angle jitter and the roundness jitter. Now we're ready to click on our new item icon. In this case, it's going to create a new brush since we're in the brushes panel. We can rename our brush and then add our new brush to the brushes panel. We can now choose the color that we want to paint. In this case, I want to disable this layer and turn these two layers back on and select layer 2. I want to be able to brush underneath the macaw. So actually I need to be on layer 1. Now I can take my brush, choose the color that I like, and the magenta brush. Feel free, guys, to play around with your brushes. Again, change the sizes, change the angle jitters, change the type of brushes, and have lots of fun with your brushes. Next, we'll move on to another painting tool. In this case, we'll switch over to our Pops JPEG of this handsome young man in the Air Force. We're going to come over here and click and hold to switch to our spot healing brush. We want to repair the damaged area of the old photograph. I usually like to resize my brush just a little bit larger than the area I'm going to repair. And this is how the spot healing brush works. You just left click and hold and drag the brush over those damaged areas or those damaged pixels, and Photoshop simply repairs those pixels. What a great tool Photoshop gives you. I'm going to click and drag over this area, and then lastly over the area at the top. Photoshop is actually making its best guess on what kind of pixels or pixel color to add into those areas. What a fantastic tool. Now we'll move on down the toolbox to some of our vector tools. In this case, we'll check out some of the shape tools. We have a rectangle tool, an ellipse tool, triangle tool, polygon tool, line tool, and a custom shape tool, which will give you a lot of preset shapes that you can use in your designs. In this case, guys, we're going to take the rectangle tool. We'll move over to our brushes and colors document. In this case, I'd like to make a new layer by clicking the new item button. And then I can click and drag my shape. Now, after you click and drag your shape, you can come over to your properties panel. The properties panel will give you all the properties for your shape. You can change things like the fill color. You can add stroke. You can increase the size of your stroke so that you can see it better. You can change the stroke type. In this case, we'll leave it on solid. If you want to round the edges of your shape, you can enter the pixel dimensions here. If on the exam they want you to add it to all of the corners, as long as this link or lock is checked or locked, you can add your pixel dimensions here, and it will add it to all the corners, or you can uncheck and add them individually. You can also come to the circles in the shape and click and drag, and you'll see as I click and drag, the numbers are changing here in the boxes. Don't forget to apply your transformation by hitting the check in the control panel or enter on the keyboard. And now I have a nice cool shape that I could possibly put some text in. If I want to add some layer styles to that layer, I can add things like drop shadows. I can decide the color, the opacity. I can change the angle. I can increase the distance of the drop shadow. I can increase the size and the spread. And I'm pretty happy with that. Now I'm going to hit OK, and I have a nice little cool drop shadow underneath my shape. The next category we'll explore is working with text. Let's move up to our window menu, go to workspace. Let's reset our essentials workspace. I'd like to pull my tools panel out, switch it to the double column. I want to make sure I'm on my rectangle layer, and I'm just going to simply hit Command T or Control T. I want to widen my shape just a little bit so I can fit some text in there. I'm going to hit enter on the keyboard, which is the same as hitting check up in the control panel. And now I'm ready to add some text. Over in my tools panel is my type tool. To have full control over my type, I want to go to window and open my character panel. The character panel will allow me to do a lot more with my text than simply the control panel at the top. I'll reposition my character panel a little closer over here where I'm going to work. You can pre-format your text by choosing the font and the size and the color and the style. In this case, I'm just going to simply click and type the word bird. I can use my move tool to move my text around the layer. And if I want to add to my text frame, I just simply hover close to the text. You'll see that my cursor is now in a box or a frame. As soon as I get close to the text, that box or that frame is going to go away. Now I know it's safe to click and add to that text. I'm going to hit return to add a few more lines so that we can control a few things here in our character panel. Let me highlight our text so we can change the size of our font. So I'll go back and change that to 300. Now I'll use my move tool to position my text wherever I want it. As you can see, my three lines of text are too close to each other and they are touching. So I need to increase what's called the leading. So in my character panel, I'm going to find my leading. Guys, remember, if you hover your cursor over the icon in the character panel or anywhere else in Photoshop, a balloon will pop up and you can confirm that that's the right area. So here I'm going to check the presets. They're not as large as I like. I can check the auto. And now that looks a lot better. So guys, remember, the leading is the space between your lines of text vertically. It's actually measuring from the baseline of the text to the baseline of the text. You may also need to change your tracking. The tracking is the amount of space between all the characters horizontally. It will increase or decrease space between all the characters evenly, uniformly, horizontally in your text. So again, we'll go to the character panel. We'll hover over this icon. We can confirm that is the tracking. I'll come and check the preset. Right now it's set to 0. If I want to make more space between the characters, I'll choose a positive number. If I want less space between the characters, I'll choose a negative number. In this case, I want to increase the space or increase the tracking. I'll change it to a much higher number, like 100. So guys, remember, the tracking is the amount of space evenly between all the text horizontally. Sometimes you may just want to add space between two single characters, like an I or a R. In that case, I'm going to get my type tool. I'm going to select those two letters. Kerning is the amount of space in between two specific characters. Not all the characters evenly. Kerning is the amount of space between two specific characters. So again, guys, you have your leading, which is the amount of space between lines of text vertically. You have your tracking, which is the amount of space between all the characters evenly or uniformly vertically. And then you also have kerning, which is simply the amount of space between two characters. Don't forget all of your different view options. Under the view options, you can show things like your rulers. You can show your grid, or you can add guides. If we want to add a guide, we simply go to Guides, New Guide. On the exam, they'll tell you whether it's horizontal or vertical or both. They'll give you the pixel dimensions. You just enter the number and hit OK. Maybe they want you to manually add a guide at a specific area. Let's say the baseline of the top line of text. Or maybe they want you to manually add a guide at the end of the last letter in the line of text. Just do what they tell you on the test, guys. Really easy. Now we'll take a look at some destructive versus some non-destructive editing. First, let's go to Window and reset our workspace. Back to the essentials. Next, let's pull out our layer panel next to our image. And let's explore our first non-destructive editing. I previously have made a selection of the McCall on the right and saved that selection. So now I'm going to go to Select and Load Selection. I'm going to choose the correct channel. In this case, it's the McCall channel, and hit OK. Now you'll see the previous selection I made of the McCall and a little bit of the branch that he's resting upon. If I go to the bottom of my layer panel and find this icon, which is the Add Layer Mask, that is a non-destructive editing. However, first, I need to make sure that I'm on the correct layer. In this case, since my selection is of the McCall, I need to make sure I'm on layer 0. Once I'm on the correct layer, I hover over the layer mask icon and click. Now you can see that white reveals where the McCall is in the image, and black hides. So black is hiding the area of the image that was not selected, which is allowing the color underneath to show through. So layer masks are considered non-destructive editing. If I want to now disable the layer mask, I can simply right click on the layer and choose Disable Layer Mask. Now we'll explore another non-destructive editing tool, which is the Image Adjustment Panel. So I'll pull the Image Adjustment Panel out and dock it underneath so we can see a little better. In this case, guys, I want to add a hue saturation. How do I know which one is the hue saturation? Guys, if you hover your cursor over the icons, they will tell you the name. So whatever image adjustment they ask you to create on the test, just make sure you hover over until you find the correct one. In this case, I'm going to add a hue saturation adjustment. You'll see that it actually adds a duplicate layer on top. It does not change the original pixels of the layer. It actually adds a duplicate layer. So now if I change the hue, which is another name for the color, you'll see it change all the colors in the McCall. You can get some pretty wild colors. Changing the hue. You can bump up your saturation to give you more of an intense color. So guys, image adjustment panels, since they add a duplicate layer and do not change the original pixels, are also considered non-destructive editing. Now we'll take a look at some more types of non-destructive editing. In this case, I want to go back to where I was when we first started. So I'm going to go down and open my history panel. The history panel is awesome. It saves all the steps that you've done since you've had the image open. So I'm just going to back up in my history panel until I get to the area that I want. If we go back under filter, I can go to Convert for Smart Filters. Guys, anything with the word smart in front of it is going to be non-destructive. I teach my students that it's too smart to be destroyed. That's why it's considered non-destructive. So I can convert that layer for a smart filter. You'll see that now my layer thumbnail changes in the layer panel. So guys, this is a way that you can identify a smart filter with this icon in the bottom right-hand corner of your layer. So smart filters and smart objects are considered non-destructive editing. Lastly, we'll take a look at some types of destructive editing. I'll select layer 0. In this case, instead of adding an adjustment layer from the adjustment panel, I'll go up to the image menu and choose adjustments. which has the same type of adjustments. I'll go to hue saturation here. I can change the hue just like I did before. I can change the saturation. I can lower or raise the brightness. Again, guys, notice this time it did not create an adjustment layer above the original layer. It is actually changing the original pixels. So if I hit OK, I have now actually destroyed the original pixels. That's why that is considered to be destructive editing. If I pull my tools panel out closer to my image and I switch to the clone stamp tool, lower the size of my brush here, hold down Alt to take a clone. I actually sort of made a copy of those original pixels of that layer when I held down Alt and clicked with the clone stamp tool. Now if I want to come over to this bird, and now I click to stamp, boom. Now it looks like the bird is facing in the other direction. But guys, again, since it did not make a duplicate layer or an adjustment layer, I actually changed the original pixels. That's why that is considered destructive editing. Okay, the last and final category we're going to review is RGB versus CMYK. Preparing for print versus preparing for the web or on-screen representation. Let's reset our workspace back to the essentials. Let's arrange our four files into four up so that we can see them all at the same time. Let's keep it pretty easy, okay? If I go up to image mode, CMYK is for anything printing. So if they ask you to prepare for print, they're referring to the CMYK color space. That's cyan, magenta, yellow, and black. That means that your file under that color space is made up of those four colors. If they ask you to prepare or change the color mode for on-screen representation or for the web, they're referring to the RGB color mode. That means that file and those color spaces are made up of three colors, RGB. So keep it easy, guys. RGB, three colors. That is for anything on a screen, a phone, a TV, a website, anything that's printed, like a book or a magazine. The four-color printing process is CMYK, cyan, magenta, yellow, and black. So keep it easy, guys. If they ask you to prepare or save the image for the web, simply click on the file that you want to export. Go to File, Export, Export As. You can change the format from PNG to JPEG or GIF. You can change the width or the height. They may ask you to change the scale. They may tell you to preserve the transparency or to turn the transparency off. They may ask you to include the copyright and contact info, and then simply hit export. If they tell you to name it how they tell you to name it. If they tell you where to save it, just follow the task and keep it easy.